As we explore quantum body, quantum reality, quantum mind, quantum consciousness, and beyond, as we explore that, I would like to share with you my real reason for this exploration. My real reason for this exploration, for this explanation, is to share with you the fundamental principle that the hard problem will never be solved if we assume matter as the ontological primitive or as the starting point of all existence. I'll repeat that. We'll never solve the hard problem of consciousness, which is how does brain produce consciousness from electrochemical activity, which means everything from sensations, images, feelings, thoughts, imagination, yearning, self-reflection, intuition, insight, creativity, higher consciousness. How does the interaction of molecules, force fields, particles create all of that? Is never going to happen. Okay. And that is because naive realism, while good for doing for tech, good for creating technology, including the one we're using right now, is never going to explore fundamental truth because it's based on the wrong premise. And I've said this many, 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 many times. I think you're probably fed up of me saying this. But one way to understand this is that the whole idea that senses inform us about an external world, you know, like my sensory experience, my five senses inform me, and me is somewhere inside here, and the other is somewhere outside there, and my senses inform me, someone inside, about a world outside. And then we're stuck. How does the world outside correspond to its representations in my brain or my consciousness? And that's essentially the hard problem. Right now you're listening and looking at me. All that's going to your brain is electrical impulses. All that's happening in your brain is electrochemistry. And how does that produce the experience of mind and body in the physical world? Is the essential hard problem. So I think we have to question that whole thing. And one particular area we should question is, do our senses inform us about the outside world? And the us meaning someone here inside me, no one can be found inside me. And the world outside me, which means the boundaries of my skin, is as much me. I can't interact without it unless I feel it as somehow entangled with me. So the senses don't inform, they project experience. Let's explore this, because this is the view both from the Vedanta, from yogic traditions, and also the Buddhist traditions, philosophies, and meditations. So let's examine the following principles. Number one, senses and world projection. The statement that our senses don't inform us about an external world, but project the experience of the world, is a cornerstone of both yogic and Buddhist philosophy. This perspective challenges the common assumption that our senses passively receive information from a pre-existing objective reality. Instead, this perspective suggests that our experience of the world is actively co-created by our minds and our senses. And there are different ways to understand this projection. First, through the entanglement of what are called vrittis in Sanskrit. Vrittis are mental fluctuations in consciousness that shape our experience. The senses become entangled with these fluctuations. projecting interpretations and meaning onto raw sensory data. What is the raw sensory data? Sound, touch, sight, taste, and smell, which are activities of consciousness anyway. So first is to understand that this way. First is to understand it's vrittis that create the experience of mind, body, and universe. We can also think of vrittis as vibrations or shaktis, and that's the, you know, yogic tradition, the Shaivite tradition. And so both Buddhism and non-dual Advaita traditions and Shaivite traditions recognize subtle energetic vibrations that form the basis of reality. Our senses and mind interact with these vibrations, interpreting them as the tangible world and also ourselves. And then, of course, you are familiar with the whole idea of Buddhist idea of interdependent co-arising, as they call it, interbeingness. Nothing exists by itself. Nothing exists in isolation, but rather arises in dependence on other factors. Nothing exists by itself, including our perception. And then there's the whole concept of emptiness of self, emptiness or formless nature of self, which is in Buddhism frequently misunderstood, the empty self. But, you know, in Vedanta, it's very clear that it is the formless, empty nothingness, which is the womb of creation. So nothingness is not implied, actually, in even the Buddhist concept of empty self. Empty self is not the absence of consciousness or real nothingness. Instead, it points to the lack of a fixed, independent, and permanent self. So every identity, I assume, as a Deepak Chopra, is not fixed. Baby, toddler, this, that, the other, male. You know, these days people are getting surgery to transfer, change their sexual identity, but ethnic identity and racial identity and religious identity and physical identity and personality as a fixed identity and emotions as fixed identity is obviously wrong. Okay. The whole idea of empty self points to the lack of a fixed, independent, permanent self. Thank God, because if we're stuck that, we would be frozen mummies for eternity. Our sense of self, like everything else, is seen as a dynamic and impermanent process arising from the interplay of sensations, thoughts, and emotions. This means then, there is no location for the self. The self isn't confined to a particular place, neither inside or outside the body. It's more like a constantly changing pattern of experiences. And experience is intermittent. Even the body, physical body, often considered the anchor of self-identity, is seen as an assemblage of impermanent processes. Our perception of a solid, continuous self is an illusion created by our mind. So what are the implications and practices? Well, the implications are very profound. Understanding the illusionary nature of self and world projection can have profound implications for our everyday lives and spiritual practice. It can lead to reduced suffering. By letting go of attachment to a fixed self, we can become less vulnerable to negative emotions like anger, fear, and craving. Why? Because all those emotions are a result of the separate self. We can also have increased compassion. Recognizing the interconnectedness of all things fosters a sense of empathy and understanding for others. And then there is the openness to liberation. If self and world are seen as projections, then the possibility of transcending these limitations and experiencing the underlying formless reality becomes more tangible. Even the formless becomes a tangible experience. So these practices, yogic and Buddhist tradition, suggest These practices offer us ways to explore these concepts. And these practices include meditation, mindfulness, and contemplative self-inquiry. By examining our own experiences and observing the impermanent nature of our thoughts, our sensations, our ideas, our opinions, our body, our mind, our personality, we can gradually gain a deeper understanding of the emptiness of self and the interdependent nature of reality. And so when we do that, we realize that who we are at the deepest level is the universe experiencing itself through this, which is also a projection of that tattvam asi. That alone is the universal, irreducible, formless, fundamental, incomprehensible, unimaginable, inconceivable, imperceivable, indestructible, untarnished being. The awareness of being is the key to liberation, and being is the formless ultimate reality. When we are in touch with being, we can use the alchemy of sensations to project new realities that will appear as physical. And today, our experiences with the VR world are already moving in that direction. Let me know what your thoughts are on this, okay?